Hello, and welcome to The Marxist Lens, a new series that presents a Marxist perspective on today's political and economic issues. In this video, we will be talking about free trade agreements. Who do they benefit? Who might they harm? What would a Marxist say about agreements like NAFTA? This is a big topic, so there will be two videos covering it. This video will outline the basics of free trade agreements and the Marxist perspective on them. The second video will specifically look at what we know about the newest trade agreement that is set to replace NAFTA, the United States-Mexico-Canada Agreement, or USMCA. We will apply what we've learned in the first video to understand the details of the USMCA. First, let's look at what free trade agreements really are. Many capitalist economists claim that free trade agreements are exactly what they sound like, the limitation of barriers, tariffs, and other obstacles to trade between countries. But there's more to deals like NAFTA than a simple agreement between countries to lower their economic guard and allow for equal and fair trade. Economist Dani Rodrik recently presented a breakdown of what modern trade agreements really entail. He categorized four major aspects of trade agreements and looked at their potentially harmful effects. The first of these is TRIPS, or trade-related intellectual property rights. These rights are a protection for innovation, making sure that those who have developed new concepts or technologies are fairly compensated for their contribution. But the problem is that TRIPS imposes rules that heavily favor advanced countries over developing ones. They allow advanced countries to maintain a monopoly on technology that developing countries are ultimately forced to buy at nearly unaffordable prices. There is a classic and tragic example of these property rights in relation to medicine. A study published in the International Journal of Health Services in 2015 found that the stronger intellectual property rights were for important drugs, the harder it was for people in poor countries to access them. In other words, TRIPS made it harder for poor populations in the developing world to receive treatment they needed. Because TRIPS doesn't allow generic alternatives to patented medicine, the only way to get the right drugs is to pay ridiculous amounts of money to have them. The second major aspect of free trade agreements is the freeing up of capital flows. The argument here is that allowing investments to move across borders without barriers should bring prosperity to all, a win-win situation. The problem is, unregulated capital flow becomes a serious liability in the event of inevitable financial crises or even periods of low stability. Naturally, this hurts weaker and less developed economies more. See, financial markets work very differently from traditional markets based on commodities. Financial markets are at risk of incomplete information or disconnect from the commodity markets themselves. Commodity markets trade real, physical things like coal, apples, or wheat. Financial markets are not quite the same. They work like an elaborate betting arena and are therefore very susceptible to the confidence of investors at any given time. During the boom periods of an economy, profits are high. As the economy approaches its peak, prices and wages go up as the demand for labor and goods rises. To expand their profits even more, capitalists borrow more money from banks, hoping to pay it back because of the profitable state of the economy. This period in the economy is where capitalists get really cocky, and the stock market rises to crazy levels from investments and the movement of money. But this fairy tale profit land doesn't last forever. As soon as capitalists start getting concerned about their rates of profit, they reduce their investments, resulting in the loss of jobs among workers. Banks start to get uneasy, so they start asking for that money they lent out. They also stop giving out loans as easily as before. Suddenly, the whole system starts unraveling in a majestic negative feedback loop as falling profits and defaults on loans accelerate. The international gambling arena crashes violently. To demonstrate just how disconnected the financial market is from the physical parts of the economy, in the 2008 crash, the stock market shrunk by 50%. The actual GDP of the world, the economy in its physical state, did not shrink by 50%. There are estimates that by the crash, the financial markets with all their complicated gambling mechanisms were circulating some $596 trillion. Of course, the more connected your country is to the international financial markets, the harder the next crash will be on your own economy. Also, the more that capital flows are allowed to move freely across borders, the more investment is encouraged. All of this simply adds to the volume of money caught up in the market so that when it all comes crashing down, as it always does, it'll be all the more severe. The third problem is something called investor-state dispute settlements, or ISDSs. What these do is allow foreign businesses to sue governments if there are ever any disputes during trade. In theory, this gives businesses protection from nationalization of industries. In practice, this gives multinational corporations the power to subject entire governments to conditions favorable for their own profit. There are many cases of this happening worldwide. When Quebec tried to pause fracking for natural gas on its territory, Lone Pine, a Canadian energy company, sued the government and won millions of dollars. Canada has lost millions of dollars in this process to American companies. A more ridiculous example occurred in one of the highest settlement awards in history. Occidental Petroleum, an oil company based in Texas, got the government of Ecuador to pay a $2.3 billion settlement because Ecuador terminated an oil concession contract. The simple fact that companies can use ISDSs as methods of suing governments raises companies themselves to the status of sovereign nations. The final issue Rodrik outlines is the harmonization of standards, which seeks to create even domestic policies across the borders for ease of trade. In other words, this feature tries to make sure that regulatory laws, wages, and tariff levels, etc., are the same for all the countries involved in the agreement. The problem here is that multinational corporations have become the central negotiators in the establishment of the standards. The issue is that the interests of multinational corporations do not align with the social welfare of host countries. Many scholars are concerned that free trade agreements are not a win-win situation at all, but rather an imposition of interests of one class on the other. Here is where the Marxists really come in. Marxists see the modern free trade agreement as the coercive effort on the part of the advanced countries such as the United States to get smaller trading partners to submit to conditions favorable to the richer countries' capital. The real winners are the corporations who lobby for the creation of the trade agreements and who play a major role in determining the details of the free trade. Meanwhile, the working class suffers on either side of the border. Take NAFTA, for example. NAFTA was supposed to create new jobs in the US and Canada and help Mexico modernize its economy. But we've seen quite the opposite take effect. Wages dropped in the United States, and Mexico's economy was restructured for the benefit of US companies. The Economic Policy Institute found that Ohio lost 50,000 jobs between 1993 and 2004 due to NAFTA. That number has since climbed into the hundreds of thousands because of the closing down and relocation of plants. NAFTA forced Mexico to repeal important tariffs that used to protect the developing country from larger and more competitive American agricultural markets. The result is that Mexican agriculture has been severely damaged. Mexico went from being self-sufficient in agriculture to being dependent on the US imports. NAFTA also required the elimination of concessions to peasants, which had previously been in place in Mexico. The trade agreement pressured the migration from rural to urban areas, which became so crowded that they could no longer sustain the larger populations. These excess populations began to travel across the border into the US looking for employment. These outcomes lead many Marxists to conclude that free trade agreements are nothing more than class warfare being waged on the international level. But that does not mean that Marxists completely reject free trade in general. Let's take a close look at what Marx had to say on the matter. Marx had laid out plans to discuss the nature and role of international trade in his multi-volume work, which he ultimately never completed. Nevertheless, we know from a number of instances that Marx had spoken on the matter of protectionism versus free trade. In fact, Marx did not buy into the debate of free trade versus protectionism. He saw the two policies as ultimately embedded in the same system, a system that remained harmful to the working class. Marx did not see protectionism in a favorable light because he believed it to largely be an effort to preserve the status quo through patriotism or nationalism. Furthermore, protectionism empowered the domestic bourgeoisie and allowed for even more exploitation of the working class at home. Protectionist policies are essentially Trump's current position on international economics. The argument is that laws should be put in place to encourage companies to stay in a country and produce affordable goods for the consumers on the market. The problem is that these policies, like the reduction of taxes, regulations, and labor laws, actually hurt the working class by giving the domestic bourgeoisie, the capitalists at home, more tools that they can use to exploit the workers. But Marx did not care for free trade either, which he saw as adversarial to the interests of the working class. If free trade resulted in the overall reduction of the prices of all commodities, as suggested by other economists, then labor itself would fall in price, meaning that the working class would suffer a loss in wages. Let's explore that notion a little deeper. We know that the value of commodities depends on what it takes to make them. The price of the commodities floats around that value. In Marx's theory, there's a distinction between price and value, but we won't get into that for this video. For now, know that generally speaking, the more expensive a commodity is on the market, the more it took to make that commodity. According to Marx, workers sell what is known as labor power, or the ability to input a certain amount of labor in a given time period. Labor is therefore a commodity, though it's a particularly special one for a few reasons. Again, we won't get into these reasons in this video. What's important is understanding that labor power is a commodity and that it is bought and sold like all other products on the market. The question is then, what does it cost to produce labor power? It's not produced in a factory or farm like other commodities might be, but it does have certain costs associated with it. For example, in order for the worker to be able to show up to work every day, he or she needs to be able to eat, sleep, recover their energy, etc. Thus, the cost of labor power per hour is a wage that will give the worker enough money to buy food, pay for a home, and account for other necessities. Returning to Marx's point about free trade, if free trade results in the reduction of prices of other commodities, the cost of labor itself will go down too, because a worker would need less money to reproduce his or her labor power. To summarize, trade simply magnifies the consequences of unlimited competition to the global level. In the end though, Marx does prefer free trade, not for its merits, but precisely for its ability to accelerate and globalize the effects and contradictions of capitalism. The answer then to where Marxists stand on the issue of free trade and free trade agreements is nuanced. On the one hand, protectionism is deemed an entirely reactionary strategy that only slows the progress of society. It's important to remember here that Marx sincerely believed in the importance of the complete development of capitalism so that it may lay the foundations for a socialist future. On the other hand, free trade is itself a policy that greatly hurts the working class. Specifically, the free trade agreements of the modern kind are nothing more than an attack on the global proletariat. Free trade is only preferable because it connects the world and therefore the working class. It makes the problems of capitalism even more pronounced. In the end, Marxists hope to do away entirely with the economic structures of capitalism. And so, they have little sympathy for NAFTA, the TPP, or any other international trade agreement. I hope you enjoyed this episode of The Marxist Lens. In part 2 of this discussion, we will talk specifically about the USMCA and how it fits into the Marxist critique of free trade agreements. For now, feel free to use the comments section below to leave questions or ideas for future topics.